Welcome to a special edition of Washington Week. Joining me tonight to take stock of today's terrible events are four reporters who've been covering the story. Joining me here in the studio are David Broder of the Washington Post and Doyle McManus of the Los Angeles Times. Plus, still on the job in Washington tonight, Martha Raddatz, who covers foreign policy and intelligence for ABC News, and Tom Gjelten, who covers the Pentagon for National Public Radio. David and Doyle, let's start here with you. What was your sense of what the president did? Did he do what he had to do?
Well, I wrote down three things that I thought the president had to do before the speech began. He had to display strength, compassion, and give reassurance. I think on the first two, he did well. I don't think that given the way in which these events have unfolded, he provided a great deal of reassurance that we know how to prevent it from happening again. And as Bill Kristol said, when it came to the strategy for countering this kind of terrorism, he was at this point silent.
He needed a bigger response, a more presidential response?
Well, I think he did what he could do at this moment, but there is much more that needs to be done.
Doyle, what is your take on it?
I think David's right. All day long, we have heard the terms of the debate over terrorism policy essentially laid out. Is this law enforcement or is it war? If it's law enforcement, you do limited things. If it's war, you step up to a much higher level. The president did not resolve that question tonight. He basically said it's a little bit of both. We're going to continue to treat it essentially as law enforcement. He didn't talk about vast new resources coming into this. He basically said we're going to do what we would do for
another. The sentence that Tom Oliphant focused on is a very significant sentence if it is translated into policy. Let's be blunt. The United States has been squeamish up to this point about saying to countries that harbor terrorists, you have a problem as long as that terrorist is living within your borders. We have not taken that kind of strong preemptive stand. If the president's sentence means that we are now about to draw that line clearly with those countries, which Richard Holbrooke was saying earlier on, we know are harboring terrorists, then it is a very significant shift.
Exactly. And to be more specific, if it turns out that this is Osama bin Laden's operation, as most of the initial fragmentary evidence indicates, the harboring country there is Afghanistan. Now, until now, the United States has carried out only limited sanctions against Afghanistan under the United Nations Security Council. If the president means what he said, then we are coming close to a state of war of some kind with the Taliban in Afghanistan.
Well, let's turn to Tom Gjelten over downtown Washington tonight. But today, when all of this happened, he was actually inside the Pentagon. Tom, give us some sort of sense about what it was like.
Well, Gwen, as you say, I was inside the Pentagon, but I was on the complete opposite side of the building. And to tell you the truth, I didn't at first feel it. That gives you an idea of the size and scale of this massive fortress, the Pentagon. It's 2 miles all the way around, remember. But nevertheless, there was an evacuation order that we all heard, and within minutes, the 20,000 people who work at the Pentagon had poured outside. By the time we got outside, smoke was billowing over the courtyard and around the building. I think none of us really realized at first until we saw that a whole chunk of the building had been taken out, a chunk of that massive fortress with the thick concrete walls. But we now know, of course, Gwen, that the plane that hit that had taken off from Dulles Airport for Los Angeles, meaning it was loaded with fuel. And as someone said, a commercial airliner loaded with fuel is like a flying bomb.
Now, prior to the plane actually hitting the Pentagon, was there a concern, was there alert within the Pentagon about the earlier bombing that had already happened, or not bombing, but the earlier crash that had already happened at the World Trade Center?
Well, of course there was, Gwen. In fact, they had already realized that it was a hijacking. They had a sense, in other words, that this was a terrorist action. Yet, significantly, the Pentagon itself had not yet been put on high alert. There was a little bit of a lag. I mean, there wasn't a lot of time between the World Trade Center bombing and the time the plane hit the Pentagon, of course. Nevertheless, when I entered the Pentagon, which was just a few minutes before the plane hit, it really seemed like quite a normal day.
Tom, I gather you weren't able to get back into the building after you left. How much of the Pentagon, how much of the National Military Command is functioning?
Well, the National Military Command Center is located inside in the bowels of the building. It was not affected by this. Smoke did get in there, but it was not enough smoke that they actually had to evacuate the command center. So the command center was, which is like the war room of the Pentagon, it was staffed throughout, operations there were, of course, continued right through the whole crisis.
And Tom, do you have any sense about the casualties at the Pentagon itself?
No, I don't, David. There were five or six stories that were completely collapsed, and there were dozens of offices in there. Now, we heard one report from a congressman who said that he'd heard that 100 people were killed and, of course, hundreds more injured. The Pentagon has not released any casualties. The one little piece of good news, as far as the Pentagon hit is concerned, is that that portion of the building was under renovation and had recently been renovated, and many of the offices there were still unoccupied. If there was one spot on the Pentagon that an aircraft could have hit with relatively fewer casualties, that was, in fact, the spot.
That's really interesting, Tom, but I'm also curious about what happens tomorrow. I noticed today there were two news briefings at the Pentagon, one at a gas station across the street, one in, I guess, what was described as a makeshift press room.
Well, they actually bussed reporters back into the Pentagon to the briefing room and then bussed them back out again. So the briefing room itself was not damaged, not affected. It was, as I say, this is where the reporters hang out. It's on the complete other side of the Pentagon. And Defense Secretary Rumsfeld said the Pentagon will be open for business as usual tomorrow. Not quite as usual, of course. A big chunk of it has been taken out of commission, but much of the building remains usable.
Well, by the end of this extraordinary day in Washington, the country's leaders had gathered to send a single strong message to those listening at home and to those abroad. That message, that the United States was wounded, but not fatally.
Make no mistake, the United States will hunt down and punish those responsible for these cowardly acts.
In addition to the president's address tonight, we heard from members of Congress and the cabinet. Congressional leaders received intelligence briefings and gathered at the Capitol, which had been evacuated earlier today, to show solidarity with the president. And Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld went before the cameras in the damaged Pentagon late today to say that the nation's military operations are still up and running. Martha Raddatz, you have been covering the State Department, you've been covering Colin Powell, and you've been covering the intelligence community. What is the latest information on what they think of this terrorism issue?
All I can say, Gwen, is everyone in the intelligence community at the State Department seemed stunned, bewildered, completely caught unawares by this. There had been a worldwide caution released on September 7th, updated on September 7th, last Friday, warning Americans traveling abroad that military facilities might be hit, civilian facilities might be hit. I talked to one administration official today. I said, what about that? Did that have anything to do with this? And he said, that had absolutely nothing to do with this. They had no information about that. We were evacuated at the State Department this morning shortly after the plane hit the Pentagon, and there were several people out in front, the special envoy to the Mideast, William Burns. I said, did you have any information about anything like this happening? He said, none at all.
What's the most startling thing? It seems the enormity of this act is part of what's so amazing about this whole day. Is that what has people consumed about what to do next?
I think what the intelligence community will do, I can hear myself a little bit coming back in my ear if they can make that stop. I think what the intelligence community has to do now is look and listen to itself at this point, and the Defense Department. All we've been hearing all afternoon is we're on the highest state of alert, security, everyone's batten down the hatches, and yet four aircraft took off, were hijacked, three hit these buildings. There is a new security problem in this country. Certainly Americans had been warned. Certainly people were saying, look, this can happen anywhere on our soil. We never know when they'll hit. But there is a new security problem here, and this is the kind of thing they really don't know how to fight. Remember a few years ago, there was an airplane, a small plane that went into the White House.
And I remember talking to a lot of security officials about that then, saying, what could you possibly do about a plane going into the White House? And they said, really, there's nothing we can do. I'm sure there were a lot of conversations today. And in fact, when we left the State Department, there were reports, credible reports, that a plane was on its way to Washington, perhaps going for another building when we're standing outside. And I'm sure there were conversations around Washington on whether or not they would shoot down an aircraft, a passenger airplane, if it was headed for a crowded building. And those are the decisions they're going to have to look at in the future and how they can stop this, because at this point, this is obviously something they don't know how to do.
Martha, from your diplomatic sources, could you make any early judgment as to how much international support there would be for an American policy that, as the president says, makes no distinction between the terrorist and the country that is harboring the terrorist?
I too was struck by that statement. I'm sure they have discussed this with the allies before President Bush went on the air tonight, and they were probably well aware of what the president was going to say. And obviously that's the kind of support they're going to have to rally in the coming days. As you probably know, Colin Powell was not in town, was not in Washington. He has been on a trip to Peru and Colombia and was called back immediately. He is now back in Washington. And I'm sure all the foreign policy apparatus will rally and try to rally the allies as well.
What about the reactions from other foreign governments? We talk about this need for some sort of consolidated response. Have we gotten an indication that we'll get that?
I think the opinion is still coming in. The broadcasts I heard today and the wires I read from overseas and what I was hearing from diplomatic sources here is that they're certainly condemning this bombing. But frankly, the world is as stunned as the United States at this point. They want to put on the best face possible. As you heard, Donald Rumsfeld said the Pentagon will be open tomorrow for business. I'm sure Washington will try to rally up. But it's a ghost town tonight, and they're reaching out to whoever they can.
Martha, you know, one of the things this event is clearly going to do is turn Washington's agenda upside down a little bit. Up until now, in the last few weeks, we'd all been talking about how there wasn't going to be any money left from new defense spending. Well, the sentiment on that is likely to change. In terms of threats there at the State Department, the worries have been about China, about the problem of missile defense. Terrorism of this nature hasn't really been that high on the radar screen. Have you begun to see the focus move already?
I think what you've begun to see is the conversation moving already. People are already wondering what this will do to a national defense system, because certainly people on the Hill will say, wait a minute, that doesn't appear to be the problem. There will be budget battles back and forth. I've already heard people today saying, look, you know, one of the reasons the intelligence had no inkling anything like this would happen is because we didn't get enough money. I think you're going to hear those kinds of arguments in the coming months.
We actually started hearing some of those arguments tonight on the NewsHour from some members of Congress. Tom Gjelten, you were at the press conference that Donald Rumsfeld gave this evening, and I'm wondering what you took away from that and whether you think he is setting himself up for some big statement. Of course, you know, there was a flurry of activity involving some bombing in Kabul, Afghanistan tonight, which turned out the United States said it had nothing to do with. What was your sense from being at the Pentagon today, what the Pentagon's prepared to do?
Well, I was told by a Navy Admiral that what happened at the Pentagon was, quote, a full assault on the United States of America. And when you have language like that, you can be certain that there will be a response commensurate with that kind of attack. Of course, General Gjelten said that he was appearing, General Hugh Gjelten, the outgoing chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, who was at Rumsfeld's side, said that he would not say what would come next, but make no mistake about it, your armed forces are ready. So while indeed they did say definitively that the United States was not behind the strikes in Afghanistan, there is virtually no doubt that there will be a response.
It also sounds like they were saying that there's no such thing as a response that's too small.
Well, when you have an attack like this described as a full assault in the United States, it's not any longer in the category of a terrorist incident. It is, in practical terms, it is an act of war.
Tom, I'd like you to give me a reality check on a theory that Doyle has already kind of alluded to. This budget gridlock that is facing Congress, my hunch would be now that any amount of money that the Bush administration asks for to beef up defense and intelligence, that there won't be 10 votes against that in the Congress, and that all of this sort of hang up about whether or not we are touching the sacred Social Security Trust Fund now disappears. But give me your perspective.
No, I fully agree with you, David, but the point I was going to make a little earlier is that this is, in fact, coming, as you say, in the midst of this budget debate. And what I do anticipate is that there will be a lot of debate about how that money should be spent. Indeed, you're absolutely right. I'm sure that there won't be any doubt that there will be more money for defense, and probably just as much as the administration is seeking. But I would guess there'll be some debate and some disagreement about how the money in that budget should be allocated, whether as much should go for a national missile defense, when we have just seen an example of a much lower tech terrorist attack on the United States, or whether there should be some shifting of the money within that defense budget, perhaps more for intelligence, more for National Guard operations to beef up preparations for terrorist attacks. So I think that there is going to be some debate about how to respond to this in a budgetary fashion.
David, Martha, I'll get to you in a moment, because I want to ask everybody this question. I want you all to take turns responding, which is, doesn't this change the context for every debate in Washington, not just for the debate over the defense budget or debate over Social Security? David?
Absolutely. I mean, we've been dealing with issues that were pretty abstract, whether or not to touch a supposed trust fund. This is real, and it's going to become ever more real as we learn the human cost of today's events.
Doyle.
In fact, I think it becomes the key challenge for George W. Bush's presidency for the foreseeable future. It's one thing to debate whether you want to put money into a tax cut, into education, or into missile defense, but when you're looking at war and peace, that's the real test of leadership.
Martha.
I was struck today, Gwen, thinking about foreign policy, and as I watched the special Mideast envoy standing out front, thinking, nobody's really going to be talking about the Mideast peace process anymore. This is a domestic issue. Americans will want to know who did it and why they did it and get them back. But I don't think you'll see as much focus on what's happening in other parts of the world for months and months and months.
But what if, Martha, this turns out to be a retaliation for our stand in the Middle East peace process?
That was certainly talked about a bit today as well. Then the focus will be on the Mideast. But in terms of what Washington talks about the rest of the world, where Colin Powell will be focused, where other secretaries in the building will be focused, I think you'll see them focusing just on this for a long time to come.
Well, Tom Gjelten, it seems as if there's not a whole lot of choice but to focus on this one issue right now, especially at the Pentagon, which is going to be the lead actor in whatever happens next.
That's right, Gwen, and I would just reinforce what others have said. I mean, if President Bush now does decide to go after Afghanistan as the country that's harboring Osama bin Laden, that will be essentially declaring war on Afghanistan. The United States will be at war, and that condition, that experience, will just overwhelm everything else.
So, Doyle, what are the big challenges which now face the United States as attempts to grapple with this, especially not only domestically, but also with our international relationships?
Well, of course, the first ones are the basic intelligence problems of figuring out who did it and coming up with a reasonable response. But the big diplomatic problem is going to be most of the world has not embraced the notion of going to war with the sponsoring country, or of something Israel pioneered, and some people in the Bush administration are even talking about, although not officially yet, and that is preventive attacks, going after them before they hit you. The rest of the world, which wasn't touched in this, would rather keep it a limited law enforcement kind of operation with a lot of international cooperation in terms of intelligence sharing. We are going to find some pushback, potentially, from some of the allies.
When you talk about intelligence, before you can even plan to do something before they do it to you, don't you have to know what's going on? That seems to have been a big gap today.
Well, you have to know what's going on, and of course one problem in previous retaliatory strikes was when you try to do a precision strike, well, you may miss the people or the person that you're going after. One of the lines we haven't crossed yet is whether to go into a much larger and less discriminate kind of strike. One of the questions here now is, will the American public and the allies be willing to tolerate larger military strikes that, yes, would harm innocent people.
That's a key point, and that's what I meant when I said we had been, our policy in the past had been squeamish, because a very important criterion was no collateral damage, no civilian casualties. If you're really going to treat the harboring country in the same terms as you treat the terrorist organization itself, then there are going to be civilian casualties. And whether or not we have the will as a people to say to those countries that harbor the terrorists, this is your problem, it's not our problem. You have to deal with these terrorists in your borders, or your people are going to feel the pain.
Martha and Tom, when you go back to work over tomorrow at Pentagon and State, what do you expect to happen? Where will you be sitting? What will you be asking? What questions will you be asking?
Well, the first question I'll be asking is to find out how U.S. troops around the world will be responding to this, what kind of mobilizations there'll be, what kind of troop movements, what kind of movements of ships and so forth. And clearly, we're all going to be waiting for the military response.
And certainly at the State Department, we want to know what the Arab countries are saying about this, what the response has been internally away from the cameras. You saw a lot of people out front today condemning the bombing, but the Arab world has not been too happy with the United States and has seen it siding with Israel. We know we had the UN racism conference last week where the U.S. walked out. The Arab countries weren't happy with that and wanted to condemn the United States for that. So that will be very interesting to see.
Martha and Tom, thank you very much. Stay safe. David and Doyle, thank you as well. We'll leave it there for now. It's been a tough day. Now, for more of our continuing PBS coverage, we head back to Jim Lehrer.